something or another, and for a minute I thought my cold was going to take over my body. But thanks be to God, rest and relaxation does help. So we are grateful today that we can come before you and tell you what thus said the Lord. Let us bow our heads. While we're bowing it, we're going to the book of Hebrews this morning. Hebrews, the 13th chapter. Hebrews, the 13th chapter. Father, I stretch my hands to thee. No other help I know. If thou withdraw thyself from us, Lord, where shall we go? We thank you this morning for being a waymaker. We thank you this morning for being our everything. Lord, without you, we are nothing, we could be nothing, and we could hope to be nothing. But with you, God, all things are possible. I thank you personally for all that you have done for every new Mount Olive Baptist Church member. I thank you, God, for what you've done to the listening congregation, those that are former students and friends and workers and family members, God, and friends. Thank you, God, for helping them to get through these past few months. And God, we thank you because we know that you are a way maker. Now, God, I decrease that you might be increased. Speak, Lord, for thy servant here. Speak to me, speak through me, speak for me, that someone will receive this message today, and God, prayerfully, someone might be saved. It is in Jesus' name that we pray now with thanksgiving, and those who believe said, amen, amen, amen. It is with much, much regret this morning to the New Mount Olive Baptist Church family that I announce the passing of dearly beloved Sister Jacqueline Wilcox. And we are in prayer, and as arrangements are made, we will inform you when we can conclude and combine the information. Amen. Amen. But we know where she is. She's not lost. Hallelujah. We know she's with the Lord. If we look this morning at the book of Hebrews, the 13th chapter, these words would be recorded in verse 8. Jesus Christ, the same yesterday, today, and forever. I repeat verse 8. Jesus Christ, the same yesterday, today, and forever. The word of the Lord is already blessed. This morning the Lord has given me, amen, in talking with a very dear friend of mine this week, as we talked and prayed, we both agreed that if he's done it before, he'll do it again. So our message this morning is, if he did it before, he can do it again. This message today is for both the believer and the non-believer in what you might be going through, especially right now. This message is for someone who says, how would a righteous God allow these things to happen to his people? Someone who doesn't know God might say, these things such as COVID-19, such as racial unrest, such as cancer, AIDS, sickle cell, such as lupus, such as unemployment, child abuse, marital breakups, and the list goes on and on. But the answer is found, beloved, again in Job 14:1. And I know not you are very familiar with that scripture, that a man that is born of a woman is but of a few days and full of trouble. For the believer, because I am a believer, and I know you are too, that you would be saying, but I'm born again. I'm washed in the blood of the Lamb. But we sometimes ask God questions because the human side does come in every now and then. And so we ask, why, God, am I going through this right now? I have trials. Lord, I have tribulations. And I don't think I can handle them anymore. Have you ever just been frustrated? Or as the cliche goes, have you been sick and tired of being sick and tired? Well, I want you to know that when you feel you're at the end of the road, I don't know that you can go any farther, you feel. I want you to know that some of us feel, why can't we believe that if the Lord has done something for us before, beloveds, whether it's something that is small and minute, whether it's something that no one even knew you were going through, whether it was something that was small that you didn't even share with anyone in your household or any of your friends, you just went through it, you prayed, and God delivered. So I don't care whether it was a small situation or a big situation that you could not handle. When you took it to the Lord, I'm here to tell you that God, that very big supernatural blessing that you needed, whether it was in a courtroom, whether it was on the hospital bed, whether it was in your home, whether it was on your job, whether it was in your community, you needed a super duper looper blessing. And when that blessing came, you knew that it was only through God. Hallelujah. You knew that you had been delivered from that trial. You knew that you had been restored from financial problems. You knew that God and God alone was the one who healed your body. You knew that God and God alone is the one that can do exceedingly above and abundantly anything we think or ask. Beloveds, if he did it before, he can do it again. And as we look this morning, I want us to look at something that all of us are subjected to. Some people are under the assumption that once you get saved, sin does not become a factor for you anymore. Or you feel that because you're good, you're kind, and you're loving, that there is no sin in your life. But I need to let you know and be reminded that sin is a very dangerous thing for and in our lives. Especially once we get saved. It seems like problems that you never experienced before now comes into play. Well, someone might ask the question, what is sin? Sin is disobedience to God's word. Sin is an immortal act that is considered to be a transgression against divine law. Sin is anything that is contrary to the law or will of God. If you lie, you sin. Why? Because God has said not to lie in Exodus 20, the 16th chapter verse. He says, thou shalt not bear false witness against thy neighbor. So if you do what is forbidden, then you have sinned. In addition, if you do not do what God has commanded that you do, you are sinning. According to James 4 and 17. So either way, the result is really external separation from God. Sin becomes external separation from God. Isaiah 59:2 says, but your iniquities have separated between you and our God, and your sins have hid his face from you that he will not hear. You see, the Apostle Paul in the book of Romans discusses sin. Paul shows that the Jew and the Gentile are all under sin. Romans 3:20 and 23 says, therefore, by the deed of the law, there shall no flesh be justified in his sight. For by the law is knowledge of sin, but now the righteousness of God without the law is manifested, being witnessed by the law and the prophets. The righteousness of God, which is by faith of Jesus Christ, unto no difference. For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God, being justified freely by his grace through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus. Beloved, Satan tries to distract us and get us away from God. Satan will try to make us think that we don't need to read our Bible. Satan will make us try to think that we don't even need our family. Satan will try to divide the family by divorce, by sexual sins, by making statements such as we outgrown each other. Satan's job is to try to deceive you and turn you away. Try to make you feel even sometimes like you're losing your mind. But I've come this morning to let you know that the devil is a liar. And sometimes we have to tell the devil right to his face that you are a liar and that the truth is not in him. You see, 2 Timothy 1 says to us, for God has not given us a spirit of fear, but one of power, love, and a sound mind. I've come to tell you this morning, do not doubt God. Don't doubt God, nor do you doubt God's word. But take him at his word. The word of God says, heaven and earth shall pass away, but God's word will never fail. If he's done it before, he can do it again. When I begin to look at situations that are in the Bible, as I begin to read and see what God has done through his word, it begins to let me know how he has manifested himself. I am reminded of him feeding multitudes of people. We've seen in the scripture more than once that he took two little fish and five barley loaves of bread, and he fed multitudes of people. And then it says that he fed 5,000 plus women and children. That means it was way over 5,000. Another scripture says that he took and he fed multitudes of people, 4,000. And women and children. It's letting me know that he said that the birds of the air, that they can call home. And he feeds even the sparrow. So if he feeds the sparrow, what about you and me? I believe that God will take care of us. I believe that he tells us that we have never seen the righteous forsaken, nor his seed beg bread. God is telling us that he is the bread of life. As I continue to read the word to see what God has done and would he do it again, I went across a scripture that talks in the book of Exodus, the 14th chapter, around verses 21 and 22. He said that when Moses was leading God out of Egypt, he had before him the Red Sea, and behind him were the soldiers coming. And I read that the Lord, when Moses lifted up the rod, that the Lord departed the sea. Oh, you don't hear me. And the people of God were able to walk across on dry land. I said, what a miracle that was. But let me tell you what God did. Some 40 years later, if you look at your word, in the book of Joshua, the 3rd chapter, verses 15 and 16, there was a young man who took over after Moses, named Joshua. And Joshua had led the people, but he had gotten himself backed up by the means of escape. But then again, Acts, the 16th chapter, it brings us into play with two more of the Lord's boys. Here now is Paul and Silas. They were trapped in jail. And the Lord allowed a whirlwind earthquake to come. And the jailhouse shook. Or as they say, the jailhouse rocked. And everything was opened up. But Paul and Silas, because they did not want the guard to be in trouble, did not escape. They had the ability to, but they waited. And I'm here to let you know that if God did it before, he'll sure not do it again. I'm here to let you know that when I search the scriptures, it tells us in Hebrew, the 13th chapter and the 8th verse, that Jesus Christ is the same yesterday. He's the same today, and he'll be the same on tomorrow. Which means that Jesus does disappointment into delight. God can turn your tears into a testimony. And God can turn your sorrow into security. God can turn your doubt into deliverance. And God can turn your obnoxiousness into an overflow. God can turn your hate into a hallelujah. God can turn your drunkenness into dreams. God can turn your gambling into giving. And God can turn your enemies into everlasting friends. God can turn your lack of endurance into eternity. God can turn your unsubmissiveness into understandingness. If he's done it before, he'll do it again. All you have to do is trust in the Lord. All you have to do is look to the hills from whence cometh your help. Your help, comes from the Lord. If you need healing, if you need deliverance, if you need joy, if you need restoration, if you need forgiveness, if he's done it before, he'll do it again. May God bless you this morning, and may his peace be upon you. If you don't know the Lord, confess with your mouth and believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead. And the word of God says, thou shalt be saved. Come on the Lord's side, because it's raining out there right now. And you will have security in Jesus the Christ. Come on the Lord's side. Give him your life and let him be there for you. Whatever it is, if you're trying to live a life for Christ, if he's done it before, he'll do it again. Hallelujah. As we go into the Lord's Supper, thank you, God, this morning, as we are going into the Lord's Supper, I want you to get your virtual communion this morning. Amen. And I want you to do what the Word tells us to do, to examine ourselves. The Lord spoke to us, and he lets us know in the book of Luke, as he tells us, he says to us in Luke, the 22nd chapter, and it tells us, in verse 15, and he said unto them, with desire, I have desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer. For I say unto you, I will not any more eat thereof until it be fulfilled in the kingdom of God. And he took the cup and gave thanks. Father, we thank you for the opportunity of being able to take your body and your blood, which was shed on Calvary for the remission of our sins. We thank you, Lord, for your goodness, your mercy, and your love. Now, God, examine each of us this morning. And if you find anything that should not be, remove it in Jesus' name. Because we want to be right. We are saved and we want to be made whole. So thank you, Lord. Forgive us of any sins of omission or commission. In Jesus' name, amen. He took the cup and gave thanks and said, take this and divide it among yourselves. For I say unto you, I will not drink of the fruit of the vine until the kingdom of God, amen, shall come. Let us eat. The bread represents the body. Let us drink. The wine represents the blood. And the scripture tells us that they sang a hymn and went out to the Mount of Olives. I don't know what your mount will be today, but I want you to remember, in everything, glorify God, because Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and tomorrow. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the presence.